Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the webinar this afternoon. My name is Amir Aryani. I'm working for ANS, and with myself today I have Dr. Jingbo Wang from NCI, who will be the co-presenter in this talk. We are going to talk about the Neo4j technology that we use as part of the Research Data Switchboard. And I will give some background. We will talk about some technical aspect of this, and then Jingbo will talk about the NCI implementation of this technology. So the agenda for the talk would be the background on the Research Data Switchboard and the research graph, which is the data modeling behind this. Then we will talk about the Neo4j queries. I have allocated something about the 10 to 15 minutes on the technical side of this. And then we go to the NCI implementation. And at the end, we will have time for questions and answers. The background on this work is it started from the challenge of cross-platform discovery of research data. It goes back to 2004 in the Research Data Alliance working group when we had the problem of finding the related connections. So some of you might have seen this slide. It's actually one of the earlier slides in this work, and I actually kept using that because it actually shows the earlier stage of the problem. And although we have solved this in Research Data Australia to a great degree, but so many repositories already they have this issue. If you have a data set and you want to know what else in the scholarly communication can be linked to this information, usually the keyword search is not an efficient way. So in this case, for example, in the ANS page in 2014, we had a data set that was actually in the page for that. We had a cross link to a data site, and we were doing the cross keyword search for title and related keywords. Now, the problem was the queries that comes back from that was including a lot of false positives. We had, in this result, we have more than 1,000 records connected to data site that were supposed to be a recommendation for the researcher that these are related information to this data set. In practice, that is not very useful when you have so many recommendations. So one of the initial ideas behind this was how the Amazon or other retail stores do this by looking at a service we call it See Also service. If you look at the book, they tell you, do you want to look at these five other books that are by the same author or by the same publisher? Or someone who have already purchased this book also purchased those other books. So usually those recommendations are very precise and are very limited. So you recommend three or five options, not 1,000 options to the end user. In this context, we started a working group in the early days. These are the initial partners that joined the group at the time to basically address this cross-platform discovery challenge. We had a significant contribution from the DryArt CERN data site, and later on we had OpenAir, DARA, and other partners joined us. In Australia we had the collaboration of NCI and also University of Sydney. And also there are other universities who have been involved in this project like RMIT or Vivo Cornell in earlier stages of the working group. Now, this is about the Research Data Alliance, and usually when I get to this part of the presentation, I talk about the structure of Research Data Alliance. I think in the scope of this talk, we don't have that much time for this, but just as a brief note that Research Data Alliance is a joint venture by main funders that they invest in the data infrastructure. And the main goal is that the people who actually work on different projects, they need to coordinate and collaborate. Now there are different working groups, and each working group have different area that they work on those. It's almost like projects. Now, in this environment of the Research Data Alliance, we had a working group which started from 2014 and concluded the main deliverables in 2015. And we are at the moment continuing the maintaining the work and extending the platform. Now, the working group, The main recommendation after multiple prototypes was that data sets can be connected using the co-authorship model. And although in principle is a simple idea, but in practice requires connecting information across different infrastructures. Now, when we were doing this at a time, we were looking at the first stage of this process was looking at how this can be done by librarians. And that's where we actually went to the process of asking a librarian, or actually we had a case study group, to look at this process and tell us what they will do so we learn from their practice. So in this context, this is a, what they call it, new version of the Research Data Alliance after a couple of updates. Unfortunately, I didn't get the screenshot from the same data set in 2014, so I have to grab a new photo. This data set is from University of Sydney, and when you, as a researcher or someone works in a library, you look at this data set, you can identify the researcher that who has worked or contributed to this data set. Well, you can actually search for that person on Google. You can find the researcher and the profile page of the researcher, including publications. When you go to the publication list, you can, if you want, read every single paper. And in the content of those papers, you will find data sets in other repositories has been cited or mentioned. So in this case, we have a data set from the Dryad repository. Now, in the Dryad repository, you can actually see the same researcher, although with different name abbreviation, and the publication is basically disconnected from University of Sydney. So the logo of University of Sydney, I just put it there in this slide to emphasize the connection, but in practice, when you are in Dryad environment, you don't know that this work is connected to a researcher in University of Sydney. So if we go through the chain of all of these connections, we will get something like we go from a data set in hands to a researcher in University of Sydney to the article in Plus One to a data set in Dryad repository. Now, this process, the first activity of the group was to actually demonstrate that it works. So we went around about, we had about 250 collections at a time. Then we did a study around that and we established the links. But obviously it is not a scalable model. You cannot do this for every single data set and every single researcher. So we decided to use machines. And in this context, so the goal here was we wanted to have a solution without spending too much time on the research and inventing new standards. So we adopted all the standards that we could from other groups and other platforms, and we try to implement something that it is simple to adopt by others and also easy to maintain. So the overall structure is basically have three different layers. The first one is a harvesting layer. It basically is OER PMA, and it reads a couple of different formats. Dublin Core is the most obvious one, but also it reads RefCS, it reads Mark 21, and DLI, DDI, and a couple of other ones from the international repositories. Now the list of these actually is in the working group list, which I believe I have a link to this further in the slides. The harvesting layer put the information into a set of machines that in this case we implemented them in Amazon, but you can do this on Nectar or any other high-performance computing platform. The main function that's required from those platforms is that they should be able to run Java programs, because everything is implemented in Java. And what those programs do is that they basically read the information from all of those points and connect them together when the connection is possible. It resolves the identifiers. It uses the cross-ref integration to get the metadata from the DOIs, the same thing for DataSite. It does the same thing for ORCID. It has a Google API integration when we have the grant or paper, and we actually search for certain domains in universities to find the profile pages. We use this one for some level of disambiguation. And then we are doing something called node linking that goes across the graph and link the nodes that there is an inference component for those connections to happen. Again, I cannot actually go to the detail of this. There is a document in the working group recommendation that talks about a relationship that called known as. So if you find two different elements that those elements are either have the same identifier that includes any kind of URI, or they are the same title with the similarity in other elements, so we link them as a known as elements, and then in the node linking stage we actually link them together. Now, the point is all of that information would get together in one database, and in the case of our project, we use Neo4j. The main reason for that was, one, the simplicity of implementation. It was very easy to hire programmers who can actually code Java and who can actually write program for Neo4j, and also the performance. So the speed of querying the database from Neo4j is much, much quicker than the if you implement something for, using the RDMS or use the same thing like a triple store. So the Neo4j was the main point of aggregating all of these connections for us. And in the data access layer, after doing something that we call metadata harmonization, which basically harmonizing the names as much as possible, or by names I mean the property names, as much as possible toward the Dublin core metadata, we ended up with a graph model that we call it research graph at the time. Now, there is one characteristic of this meta model which is different from the other schemas that you're harvesting. This one, first of all, it's run mainly by URI. We have the URI for most of our elements where it is possible to convert information to URI. The example of that is converting the DOI to URI, converting the grant ID to PERL. Everywhere that we had the option to convert something to URI, we have done it. And that enables the scalability of this graph to a distributed graph across multiple platforms. And the other thing is we have the separate relation object, which if some of you are familiar with RefCS, in RefCS we have the party record, we have a data, which is a collection, we have services, we have activities. In this model, also we have a relation object. And the advantage, the main advantage of doing this is that it enables connecting the nodes to a URI which actually don't exist in our ecosystem. Example of this is that if you are looking at the data repository in a university, you might have actually ORCID record as a related identifier. And in this model, we just put a related relation object that says this record is linked to ORCID, and we don't have to resolve it. It sits there. By the time later on in our inference model, we can resolve the record to that ORCID identifier, and then the graph system actually handles this as a bidirectional relationships between nodes. Now, I were not supposed to talk about too much about architecture because we have a lot to talk about the actual Neo4j queries, so I just go ahead quickly on this topic. These are examples of multi-degrees of separation. I'll just go through one of them. So two databases can be connected. For example, if a data set has the contributor, which is the author, and that author actually published a paper, and that paper cited another data set. This is what we call 3 degrees of separation, and we have multiple of those based on different scenarios. This is a link to the research graph model. In the interest of time, I think I will skip this slide without talking about the individual elements. There's a link to the schema, and if you have a time at the end of the webinar, and if you have questions about that, I can actually come back and talk about the schema later. And these are the links. The slides will be available, so you can actually, you don't need to write this slide, write the links later on, you will get the slides and you can click on these links. The next part of the talk is about Neo4j. So that was actually the main motivation for this, another review of the switchboard project, if you like. We implemented the research data switchboard in multiple different institutions. In Australia, NCI has adopted that, University of Sydney has adopted that, and is using this. And also in Europe, we have multiple partners who are using this technology. Now, we came up with the same questions again and again, and these are different queries that people ask, how can I do this? How can I find my data set using DOI? How can I find all the data sets that are from this particular publisher? So in this part of this presentation, I'm going to walk you through some of these scenarios. Now, one thing about the Neo4j is that it has a graph browser, and for the purpose of this presentation and also for the research data switchboard, we have the extended version of this browser website, which has some built-in functionality for the queries related to the related to these scholarly works. Basically, you can think about this as an extended graph explorer for Neo4j. In this environment, one of the things that you can do as an example of the cipher queries is that you can search for a data set. And what I'm going to do is that I'm going to search for the same data set from Dryad that we just looked at it in our example. So here I can say I want to see the DOI. Let's steal the DOI from the slides. So what I said is that give me a data set from Dryad when there is a DOI and that DOI equal to this. When I do that, it basically comes back with the kind of red slash orangey dots that represent that data record. You can look at the content of this here. It tells you this is a record from Dryad, this is a title, and these are a list of authors. Now what we can do in this environment, we can actually query this by either double clicking on that or just do a one click and then click on the expand button. So here you will get the other information. There are four other data sets in the Dryad environment linked to this. There is a paper, which is this one is from Plus One article. This was also in one of the earlier slides, and this is a researcher. Now in this environment, I can keep expanding the nodes and what they call this traversing through the graph. So here I can see all the publications for that record, for that researcher, which in this case is Catherine Bilov, and then all the grants that she got. And also for these grants, some of them actually have connections, and I believe one of them is also connected to another data set. Now this data set, now in this environment, if I want to look at the metadata of the record, I can actually expand this thing in the bottom of the page, and here I can see the title, which this is the first data set that we started from it. So back to the point of multi-degrees of separation, here I have a data set that it is linked to a researcher, the grant, and goes all the way back to the initial data set. Now, in this domain, you can do a set of queries, and I actually have a list of things that we need to look at it. So we will going to look at the how to find a data set, how to find a publication, grant, and researcher, how to find links to ORCID record, how to find data sets that have DOI, how to find DOIs using prefix, find highly connected data sets that is using a number of edges on the graph, connections with multiple degrees of separations, and find shortest path between two researchers. Now, this might end up to be a bit overwhelming with going through all of these cipher queries. What I will do is that if some of these things feel complicated, the slides will be available online, so you can actually always go and try them and then basically send me an email and we can have an offline conversation about the syntax of the queries. In this case, so we did already check finding a data set by DOI, but you can also find a data set by title. So the way that it works is that you any node in our research graph model has a property called title. And in this case, the title for the data set is the one that we get from the metadata record. Now this is a simple query. You can do the same thing for publication. You can actually get the publication record. This is one publication query from a CERN database. Now I can go here, I can actually post the same query here, and then I can actually get this record from the database. Now one thing I want to point out is that if you see the query that you run, it actually can take longer than usual because the size of the graph is, it is a big database, and in this case we have about 6 million nodes in this graph database. And what we have just run here is that it's asked for a string search in a graph database. For some of us who are familiar with the architecture design of databases, the graph database is not designed for string search. Now, there is a trick about this, and when I was doing this, I thought it would be a very, very good example. In this case, it goes actually through the 6 million nodes to find the related element, but we could actually do this much better by just making this query more precise. If we know it is from CERN, we could just add the CERN namespace here, and also we can add the limit number at the end. What it does, it says the first one that you found it, come back, don't go for the rest of this. I know it's only one instance of that. So what I do here, if I hit the enter button, it comes back immediately. So the way that you make the query have a direct impact on the performance that you get from the graph database. Now, this is another example of how you can find the title. This is the same as a data set, so there's no complexity about that. There is I want to find a record from CERN, that is a publication, and it has a title, and this is a title for that. Now, for the grant, we have another property that it is useful, and that is called PERL, persistent URL. In Australia, for all the ARC and NHMRC grants, we have PERL, which basically is this namespace and the grant ID is at the end. Basically, you will have perl.org/auresearch/grants, and then a slash, if it is ARC, it will be ARC-grant number. If it is NHMRC, it's going to be NHMRC-grant number. So I can actually copy the same query and go here and paste it. But before I paste it, I want to show you another thing. Every query that you type, you can actually hit this button and add that to your favorite. So I have the list of the favorite of all the queries that I want to run, just in case that I forget to type one of them. So in this case, I can actually go to this list and click on that. It's the same query. I can run it. And just to make it quick, I say, just give me one. Now, this is our grant, and you can look at the content of the grant here. Now, the same thing, you can actually search for a grant by title, obviously. Now, for the researchers, there are a lot of options. You can search the researcher by first name or last name. You can search the researcher by ORCID, and also you can search the researcher by Scopus ID. In this system, we actually get the Scopus IDs which are linked to ORCID, and we index them. So if you're looking for a researcher with a Scopus ID, you can actually find that, and the query would look like this. So you say, I want a researcher with a Scopus ID equal to this, and give me that researcher. Now, this query, I think now we're getting to the queries that are more complicated. So what we are going to do here, we are going to find a connection. So I'm not only looking for a particular node, I'm looking for a node that satisfies the specific criteria. In this case, we are looking for a record from Dryad, that it is linked to a record from ORCID. Now, one thing is, if you ever try to copy this information, copy these cipher queries into PowerPoint presentation or Word or other text editors, what they do, they fiddle around with the format of this dash and other specific characters. So just be mindful on that. When you copy and paste, sometimes they actually been distorted. So back to the topic. In this case, we have a data set, and the data set is from Dryad. And this syntax basically says, I want the only nodes from Dryad that are linked to ORCID. And then I want to get the count. I want to know how many they are. So this is actually introduction of another syntax here, which is a count element. You can actually, rather than returning the nodes, you can return the number of nodes. So in this case, we have 1,231 Dryad data sets that are actually, data set and publications that are included in the ORCID profiles. And the way that we can actually see what they are, we can just say return n, just give me 10 of those records. I get these ones. I can expand one of them randomly. So this publication, now actually this is another opportunity I'll explain another thing. Now, when you look at the node in the research graph model, there is multiple labels for each node. The labels identify the source. So in this case, we have one publication which came from ORCID and Crossref. That means we have two different sources for information that have the metadata for this record, and then we merge them. Now, in one of the early presentations, someone asked me, what will happen if there is a conflict about this metadata? What will happen if the title in ORCID is different from title in Crossref? The way that we manage this is that there is a priority in the... this basically, there are different sources that have authority about different information. For example, anything that is related to DOI, if that DOI is registered with Crossref, the information from Crossref will override other nodes. So let's say in this case, the title in the ORCID record might be modified by the researcher. When we ingest this and then we do the integration with Crossref, we actually override the information from ORCID by the Crossref when it gets to the DOI. Now, I know this might actually lead to false negatives, but this is actually for us was the most practical way to manage that. Now, this publication, we can expand it. It goes to the ORCID record. And if we expand the ORCID record, we might get some information attached to that, which in this case we didn't. So that is just one ORCID record linked to one publication. Going back to our slides, now, this is another type of query that might be useful for many of us, is how do I find the records in ANTS that are linked to ORCID? So in this case, I want to look for records in University of Sydney that have been contributed to the Research Data Australia, and they have a connection to ORCID. So the only difference here is that I use a new element that called ANS group. Now, there is another characteristic of our graph model is that unlike many different, well, some schemas have a concept of profile. In our graph model, we do not have actually the concept of profiling. What we do is that we have a standard sort of field, but also the repositories which are with their own domain-specific fields, we can ingest them into the system. And that's actually one of the examples that we did for NCR, ingesting the organization nodes into the graph structure as they had in the GeoNetwork data model. And it works because the system is actually agnostic to the metadata elements in the individual nodes. So basically, in a graph database, you can have a hybrid model. So in this case, we have ANS group, which is a metadata element from ANS, and we say, okay, that is equal to the University of Sydney, and give me 10 records of that. So these are the records from the University of Sydney in ANS, which they have a connection to ORCID. So for example, this is a data set. I can expand this. These publications are cross-ref publications. I don't see any ORCID record here. Actually, yes, it is. So this is our ORCID record. Okay, so this is another example of, this is another useful thing. One of the things that you can do in the graph database, you can search for properties. So I want to know all the data sets that they have the UI. And I can actually copy and paste in our graph database system, and we can hit the enter button and see how many data sets we have here that has the UI registered to it. So the answer is 57,000 records in our database has a property called DUI. Now you can replace this with other properties. Like we say, I want to see all the grants that actually they have per. The answer is 45,000 grants. Now the other example, or one of the queries that we had, especially from our European partners, was finding the data sets by the prefix under DUI. Basically, the goal of this is you want to actually find the data sets from particular journal or from particular publisher. So this actually uses a syntax that's called regular expression. In the Neo4j, you put a tilde after the equal sign, and then you put the dot star at the end, which that means everything after that is acceptable. So when I do that, it will return a lot of data actually here. So I put a limit 10, and it gives me 10 records that those records have this DOI. So you can individually look at the metadata, or I can just click on rows and I look at the record for this. All of them have the DOI that matches my criteria. Now, another example here would be how we can find the highly connected data sets. So the things are getting more and more complicated here. And I have good news, I have only two of these complicated queries to go. So here, what we have done, it says, okay, I want to see all the data sets based on the number of connections that they have. What we have done is that we say, okay, I want to get a data set. Actually, this query is for ANS. So I want to see all the ANS data sets that have the most number of connections. So I say, okay, well, give me the key for that record. Give me the title of that. So I want to know what it is. And I want you to actually count the number of connections that it has, sort them by the number of those connections in the reverse order. You do that, it goes into the system and comes back quickly. So here we find all the data sets that we have by the number of connections that they actually link to them. So if you actually look at this particular node, we will end up 757 nodes linked to that particular data set. Now, this is the last of our queries, and this is a scenario, actually, no, sorry, I did a lie, there is one more. This is an example of finding the links that go through the multiple degrees of separation. The application of this query is a scenario like this. I am working for ANS, I'm thinking, how many connections do we have to draw up? Well, we might have connections directly, but we might also have connections indirectly. The example of indirect connections would be, I have a data set or a paper in ANS registry that is actually claimed by a record or a profile in ORCID, and that profile in ORCID also has a connections to Dryad. So the syntax for this would be something like this, that says, I want to get all the connections between 1, 2, 3. So if I run the query like this, and the outcome is return title and the key, and only 25 of them, what it does, it actually returns the node title, so this is a link from ANS, and then we have the dataset key from the dryad. Now, the last of our queries are, I found this one interesting for a lot of people in the publication domain when they are looking at the researchers or datasets or two different datasets, and they are wondering, are these two actually connected? What you can do in a graph database, you can search for something that called shortest path. Ah, that is an example of the copying and from the browser is not a good idea. I don't know how these characters end up here. Actually, I go back to my list and I pick this one as the last query. I don't have this one saved. Okay, so we have to fix it. So what this query has done, it says, okay, I want to have a dataset from dryad with this DOI, and I want to have a dataset from ANS with this DOI, and find me the shortest path between these two. And it does. It looks like this. So it says these two datasets are linked using a researcher and a publication. Now, in this case, you can actually replace a dataset with a researcher, and instead of DOI, you can use ORCID. You can replace a dataset with a grant, and instead of DOI, you can use PERL. Now, if you use the extended version of Neo4j with the research graph model, you will actually get this last tab here, which you can open it, and it has a template for all of these queries. So, for example, for the shortest path, I can click here, and it fill up the box automatically for me, and I only need to actually fill up the the DOIs that I need. And we are actually extending this further. So at the moment, we have about 10 queries here as example, and we are planning to add more and more queries to this template. So this is basically the last slide for the Neo4j queries. What we will do is that I hope at the end of the presentation, we will have a time to have a discussion about this question Q&A. The next part of the talk is by Dr. Jingbo Wang about the NCI. I believe I did not actually introduce Dr. Wang. Dr. Jingbo Wang is actually working as a data collection manager for the NCI, which is located in ANU in Canberra. Her background is, this is actually was a tricky one which we tried before the presentation. I believe she got her PhD in the seismologist, which is in the geoscience. And basically, her mission at the moment in NCI is connecting information across different platforms by basically providing this ecosystem for researchers and make the research environment more efficient. Now, with that introduction, I will hand over this presentation to Jingbo.
Hello, everyone. I will use about 10 to 15 minutes to share my experience as a user of RD-Switchboard. And I wanted to show the graph connection experience using our NCI metadata. And this talk has also been presented 2 weeks ago in the first Reproduce Science workshop in Hannover, Germany. It got positive feedback. So for people who doesn't know much about NCI, NCI is, in short, is for National Computational Infrastructure. So we are the national level supercomputer center physically located at Australian National University campus. From 2013, we received a big chunk of money to store the research data. The motivation is some of the data getting bigger and bigger to gigabyte, terabyte, even much larger, especially in our domain, such as environment. It's growing so fast, an individual PC or hard disk cannot store those large-scale data, and transferring data and share the data became a problem. That's why we got this funding as one of the 8 node storage to support the research data infrastructure. At the moment, we have more than 10 petabyte research data. As you can see in this figure, our data including from the space, astronomy observation, to satellite images, and climate model, climate change research, ecosystem, onto the ground, like geophysics exploration, and even deeper mantle core geodynamic processing data. With the funding of being one of the research data infrastructure, we make use of the advantages to work on the data that we collected to make a seamless connection across different disciplines. So as you can see here, we care about data formats because we want to make use of the HPC facility. And we care about provide open access to researchers because the large scale data, it's impossible for them to download to their local machine and do the processing. It's better to provide some kind of virtual environment for them to log in and do a big processing at our center. Because we have this so much data, we need to organize the catalog for people to know what data set available at NCI. So this is one of the common questions researchers care about. The catalog we built based on a rational relationship between researcher, data, grant, and the paper. For example, if you see the first line, it says researcher A used data 1 supported by grant A generate paper 1 and 2. Similarly, for each line, we have one record. However, the obvious thing here is we can see the redundancy of researcher B appear twice, data 1 appear twice, grant B appear twice. If every single node is in our database, it creates a lot of redundancy. So the idea of adopting RD-Switchboard is we use the idea of identifier. And we use the identifier of the same researcher, like ORCID. We use the same identifier of the data, like a DOI. We use the same identifier, like a Perl of a grant, etc. Now, after we merge those different nodes with the same identifier, actually each entity of researcher data grants and paper are now connected through a graphical relationship. I think that's my understanding as a user how RD-Switchboard can help us to make the connection. Because with this graph view, what I can answer question would, for example, like what is the usage of NCI's dataset? It can be translated directly to an RD-Switchboard query that Amir just showed you a little while ago. How many datasets published at NCI are being referenced in the research journal articles? Another question such as, what is the awareness of the available datasets within the research community? It can translate to a query question, that is, how many researchers institutes are connected to the datasets, and so on. So the third question, which is even more specific, if I would like to know more about this dataset, who should I contact? Who generate this data? Who used the data to publish the paper? And what is the previous research has been done using this dataset? I believe this is a very common question for researchers. When they start a new topic, they would do this kind of research, like myself, doing a Google search first. But if we provide this kind of infrastructure, it will make the researcher, the literature review, much easier. Now, I will use two slides to explain exactly how we organize our catalog and then adopting RD-Switchboard technically. So we organize our catalog in a hierarchy structure. On the top node, as you can see here, it's an NCI GeoNetwork node, which is only about a top collection level, high level summary of the data collection. At the moment, we have more than 200. And on the middle level, you can see every single project has its own GeoNetwork catalog. GeoNetwork is our metadata display interface, but you can use other interfaces as well. So at NCI, for each individual project, we might have thousands of records in the file level or granular level. It's not appropriate to have all this different granularity catalog in a single node, because we then it's hard to separate them, and it's hard to aggregate it by research domain, for example. So we use this structure, and it provides flexibility for us to do more aggregation at a later stage. You can check out our main GeoNetwork website using this link. So what RD-Switchboard do is, every single GeoNetwork has its own individual database, and we dump those databases into the RD-Switchboard graph database, and the connection has been made. Here, I don't show the exactly how it does, but that's the magic where it happens in this box when the identifier was used to merge the different nodes so that the connection has been made. This screenshot is the current status that using NCS metadata, we find some connections, for example, between the datasets, researcher, and institute. But I also noticed that there are nodes are disconnected. In my follow-up processing, I actually found out they are actually connected, but in our metadata, because it lack of some critical information. So when I present this database in a graphical view, it's disconnected. It means that I have to correct some of the metadata information in our database. So far, as I explained, the RD-Switchboard helped me identify some missing critical metadata entries, which I can make it more complete. Sometimes it also helped me identify the errors in the catalog, and I can easily fix it. But without RD-Switchboard, it's almost impossible, because we have thousands, hundreds and thousands records. It's hard to check manually, but RD-Switchboard can tell me immediately. The RD-Switchboard graph view provides analytical view of how research data has been used so far. This has been a very common question being asked many times by our user, because they care about who used their data, and they care about how to make the data even more public to make more connections to the external world. And RD-Switchboard is an ideal tool to make it happen. It also can help me evaluate the impact of the datasets, researchers, and institute based on assumption that more connection an entity has, it has a bigger impact, if you like. Finally, as you see in the example in Amir's demonstration, if a researcher doesn't have ORCID, those queries wouldn't work. So it's really a good motivation or encouragement for researcher to register ORCID, for data manager to mint a DOI for their dataset, for data repository to provide a persistent identifier to increase the accessibility of the dataset. So this is our experiences so far. I would like to end up my presentation by giving you a real example that how I feel it is really helpful from a data repository point of view. And that is the basic question, what datasets are connected to each other? So we have a group from the Bureau of Meteorology, and they download the climate reanalysis data from US because it's too large, and there are a number of people want to use that data. So they approved by NCI to store at NCI so that they can use it. After a little while, another group from CSIRO, also climate research group, they are downloading the climate reanalysis data from the same source, but different portion, different subset, and they want to do some research. However, those two groups don't know each other, but they both came to me, would like to find some storage at NCI to support their research. And I suggest them, since you share the common interest, why don't you talk to each other, see if group A already downloads some data that group B can use, and vice versa. And then they start talking to each other. After a few months, a third group, which is also from the Bureau of Metrology, but a different branch, and they are asking something very similar, some questions very, very similar about using and sharing reanalysis data. And I suggest the same thing. However, as a human being, as a communication hub, it's very difficult and it's hard and it's time consuming. I can see a good chance for RD-Switchboard now play my role as a communication hub to present those connections automatically in the graph database so people can go there anytime, 24/7, check the connection of their data set and start talking to each other without talking to myself. It also reduces, it might also motivate a collaboration from different group when they see the connections. So that's my hope that the RD-Switchboard, when NCI adopting it, so we can offer those kind of services to our user. So in summary, the RD-Switchboard is a great tool to create a linkage among researchers, datasets, and the publications. The Neo4j graph view is a very eye-catching and straightforward to understand complex interconnections within the research community. I also feel this data management is a joint effort by the whole research community and the librarian community. And that's the end of my talk. I will hand over to Amir as a presenter.
Thanks, Jingbo. Thank you very much. What will happen after this? After this webinar, we will have a BOF in eResearch conference. That will be one place that you can find us. I believe Jingbo would be there as well. And we also have Nathaniel from University of Sydney. We will talk about this technology further in the BOF. And for some of you who are interested to get that Neo4j database that I was using for demo, that's actually quite a big file. I can give you that one with the USB disk, so that's one way of getting that. So that is a quick way. In next week, if you come to the eResearch conference, if you find me, I can give you the file. If that doesn't happen, then Jingbo and I, we are actually putting that database on the NCI platform as open access repository, so other people will be able to download it. But that is a publication that we are doing, we are in the middle of it, so I don't know exactly how long does it take for that data set to appear. It should be that one also soon. Regardless, the slides will be available online. If you have any further questions about this Neo4j technology, you can send me the email on this email address. The entire code for both Research Data Switchboard and the Research Graph Database structure all on GitHub. So the links are on the repository, are on the earlier slide. I can also bring a screenshot from this. So what will happen is the first thing you probably would need to do if you want to create a graph database, you might want to go to Neo4j and download the Neo4j source code and compile it. But the easiest way would be we have a Neo4j repository here that actually compiles. So every plugin, everything has been built. We can just download it and run it. So that will be your database, ready to go. Your schema is on the schema repository here. And also there is a page on the web that explains how the schema works. There are some crosswalks on the repository that you can look how you can do the crosswalk if you want to import it. In the Neo4j structure, if you remember, there was a harvesting point. So when you do the harvesting, the information needs to go to the switchboard, and the switchboard data is all on the GitHub repository under the switchboard name. We have a multiple instances also here. So multiple repositories here. And the code that, as Jingbo said, make the magic happens is in the inference repository. Now we have about 5 minutes that we can actually allocate to question and answer. So we have one question from Christopher. So the question is that what processing power is required for the queries? Okay. So the answer to this is that it very much depends on your two things. Actually, graph size is the obvious element, and the other one is your indexing of elements for your properties. So in the ideal world, if you index everything, then that obviously makes it much, much quicker. That reduces the computation power, but requires more storage. The trade-off would be you can actually index less properties, and then you will actually need to have more computation power allocated to that. But the example that I've shown, it was actually in my MacBook Pro, which has a i5 processor. So as a 6 million graph database, I'm running the GoToWebinar software, plus PowerPoint presentation, and also I have a Neo4j running on the background. So that is not expensive to run. The thing which is expensive to run is an inference engine. That one, it requires a high-performance computing and a lot of memory because it is a multi-thread processing. So in our case, in the Amazon, we have a machine which I believe it is in one of the earlier slides. That machine has 36 cores and 60 gigabytes of RAM. And that machine takes about 72 hours to complete the pipeline. But if you have a machine, so the way that it works for the way that the pipeline works is if you have a machine with half of the power, it doesn't take twice the time. It actually makes 8 times longer. So for the running the inference engine on the large graph database, you need a very powerful machine or a set of powerful machines as a cluster. Now, this actually opens a conversation about something that's called distributed graph. I briefly mentioned that, and that is why this graph project are now more adopting the idea of having a cluster of graph running on different platforms, and that is something that we probably need to open the conversation in another webinar or another technical meeting. So I have one question here. It says, for RD-Switchboard, is a form-based search option planned rather than the search query string? Yes, the answer is yes. We are working on a couple of different options for this. One is that at the institution repositories, we are at the moment exploring the idea of having the integration right into the repositories like DSpace that enables just the whole platform to work like a plugin. And also in the Research Graph website, we are working on the idea of providing, as you said, form-based search, so you can actually type your queries and get to the graph without actually loading the whole Neo4j. Okay, so the question says, is there any study comparing the Neo4j graph with other traditional views? And there are two different comparisons here about, so the question here is there any study about comparing the Neo4j technology and other technologies? There are a lot of actually studies on the web. If you search Neo4j compare, and if you do this on Google, it brings lots of other options. So there are studies with comparing Neo4j with traditional databases, like a SQL database. There are comparisons with the Neo4j with the non-SQL databases, like MongoDB. And then there are comparisons between Neo4j and the triple studies. So in this context, the first one is quite obvious. The SQL databases that are tuned to the string-based search and that have different structure. The problem of those databases for this kind of scenario is that finding the chain of relationships is very, very expensive process to do. NoSQL databases, well, Neo4j is one of those. So you are comparing different items in the same category. There are a number of those options. There is another, for example, similar product in this category that's called OrientDB. There is another one that's called TitanDB, so there is a couple of those in these groups. You can actually search on the web for finding the different performance differences. The main differences are the performance, the simplicity of the use, and the interoperability with other tools and platforms. And the semantic web, the main difference between Neo4j and a triple store is on the inference model. I would say Neo4j is far less capable of making a complex logic, but at the same time, it provides you with the simplicity of implementation and the performance in query. So it's much quicker to get the data from Neo4j. However, there are different triple stores. There are different technologies. And I remember in 2014 when we were doing the project for the first time, we did some case studies at a time. Our experience suggested that the triple store technology requires more computation power. But that might have been changed in the last 2 years. Okay, so the question is that is the complexity of inference improve the search quality? The short answer is yes, it does. So the last question is the RD-Switchboard implemented in the Search Data Alliance? In a way, yes, it was a collaborative project that was initially started by Anne Dryad and CERN, and then other people joined. So we had the infrastructure contribution, we had data contribution, we had coding contribution from different partners. And overall, we can say this is the implementation of what the working group recommended. So the working group came up with a recommendation of different connections, and then we implemented that in the switchboard model. And the question was about the Research Data Australia. So the actual question was, is RD switchboard implemented in Research Data Australia, which I misread that. So the answer to this one is that we use the Research Data switchboard to enrich the Research Data Australia. It's one of the linking capabilities that ANS has. But at the moment, we do not have the graph visualizer. This is one of the items in our pipeline, which we already have this one planned into our development cycle. And in the future versions of the Research Data Australia, we are working to have a graph visualizer that provides some of this information. Okay, thank you, everyone. I believe I'm 4 minutes over the time of the webinar, so I would like to thank everyone for attending the webinar.